I had this information, didn't know what to do with it, finally gave it to Resi. When we cleared out our first city in Holland, Eindhoven, the land was between Eindhoven and Tilburg. Tilburg was still held by the enemy. And of course, there we were in Eindhoven. Colonel Sink called me. He says, I want you to stick with the underground people until we find out who is ahead of us northerly by direction over our regiment. Get to that line in Tilburg and phone the information to us here in Eindhoven. And I asked, how do I go? He said, the Dutch people will give you a uniform to wear. Now that scared the living hell out of this soldier. I'm to go as a civilian with the Dutch underground to where this phone was to phone in the information that they wanted. And I am in civilian coveralls. I did this for 3 or 4 days, scared to death because you know what would have happened to me if they were caught. Without any trouble whatsoever, we did what we were supposed to do. I got back with my unit up the road from where we were supposed to kick the Germans out of Holland, where the Brits were having big trouble. Arnhem and Nijmegen. They never did get through Arnhem because they didn't listen to the Dutch underground in the first place. They were told that there were a lot of armor, a lot of people guarding those areas, and they were not going to allow us to just go through as Montgomery said we would. Very simple. So we're stuck on a little place called an island between Nijmegen and Arnhem on the Rhine River on outpost. My outpost was on the Rhine River. One night I was checking my outpost and something came across the river. When I used to check on the river about 3 or 4 days, I used to stick my hand in that river feeling how cold it was and how fast it was going by this brick factory. And I thought to myself, nobody could actually swim in that river, nor could anybody cross in it in boats because it was going so fast. And out came a gentleman by the name of Colonel Dobie, D-O-B-E-Y. We were astounded. One of my men helped him out of the river. He told his tale that they had 150 Red Devils across the river in hiding by the Dutch ground, in the ground, underground, to take him to somebody that could tell him how they could get him all across back to our side. We put a call in. They told us to take this man to regimental headquarters, which they did. The next night, a truck came in front of my little headquarters. I was told to get in the truck, two of us, officers, two of my friends from the other platoons, and in the front of the truck was our battalion commander. Took us to his place where we were told and shown how we were going to rescue those soldiers across the river. They were going to do it by bringing up canvas boats. They were going to be manned by our non-coms. We were going to be trained to run those boats across by British engineers. I opened my big mouth and asked the brigadier who was briefing us that we were going to send our men to rescue British soldiers and we were not going to have our officers participating. He asked me, he said, Lieutenant, are you volunteering? I said, no, sir, I don't volunteer for anything. He said, would you go? I said, I would go with my men anywhere because I don't allow my men to go anywhere. I won't go. The next day, I found myself with the other two officers who appreciated me very much volunteering them, practicing how to row boats across the Rhine. We went across the Rhine, brought back almost 150 British paratroopers, including four American flyers that were being hidden by the Dutch underground in this group, waiting for the time to be rescued by American forces. I thought that was a pretty good mission. We stayed in Holland for 72 days, went back to France for R&R. I was one of the first officers to be named to go on leave. I hadn't had leave. I hadn't had leave that we all had in England after Normandy. We were waiting for General Bradley. Couldn't go on leave. I was named to go to Paris for 3 days. I had money to burn. I hadn't been paid full pay since April. And all I could think about is blowing this big chunk of money for 3 days in Paris, the heaven. And I was to be a convoy leader of two trucks, taking all these GIs and one other officer in the other truck, and that's going to be on the 17th of December. We got in the truck, we were all pretty oiled up with cheap champagne that we could get for a nickel a bottle, because we were in Reims area of France where the champagne's made. We got a bottle of champagne for a pack of cigarettes. We didn't smoke much cigarettes, we drank a lot of champagne. I was on the road to Paris. Paris was 80 miles away. I got 72 miles from Paris, and my truck driver, GI truck, 6x, he said, "Sir, there's a MP, or we call it shoot patrol, following right by my truck. What should I do?" I said, "The hell with it, we're going to Paris." He says, "Sir, he's a captain." I said, "Better pull over, pull over." Captain came around, he said, "Lieutenant, pull this truck around, we're heading back, you've been alerted." So I said, why in the hell would he send a captain to pick up the guys to come back? He said, "I was told by Colonel Sink himself that if we sent a lieutenant, you would be in Paris, not where we're located." Got back to camp, didn't have time to even change uniforms. Get in your battle fatigues, take all the weapons you could find, all the weapons and ammunition you could find, get on these open trucks. You're heading somewhere, the enemy has broken through. Next thing I knew, next morning, we landed at a place called Bastogne. Unloaded the trucks, couldn't hardly see your hand in front of you, it was foggy, it was early in the morning, and cold as hell. We could see a Jeep pulling up in front of my platoon, whether it was by chance or whether it was by design, I do not know. Colonel Sink got out of the truck, got out of the Jeep, came up to me. He said, "James, take patrol up this ditch and find out what the hell's in front of us." No big deal, that was our job, the patrol platoon. I said, you, I could obtain any one of my men, because they were all trained by me. Let's go. Picked a guy by the name of Popeye, McClung, Stroll, anyhow, two others. I said, "Let's go." Started up the ditch, we got into the woods, you could hardly see anything, but you could listen, you could hear. And in wartime, when you're on patrol and you're on your combat area, you could hear anything. Anything rattle, and you could all kinds of noises. And we heard this familiar noise. Stroll whispered, he said, "Sir," he said, "I hear something and I see something." I said, "What do you see?" And about that time, a little bit of the fog lifted. He said, "They look like haystacks to me." Popeye always had something, a joke. He said, very whispering, he said, "There may be haystacks, but you see, the damnedest haystacks I've ever seen, the damn things are moving." A little more fog lifted. McClung says, "Sir, they are tanks, and I counted 12. I said, "Let's get the hell out of here now," which we did. About 5 minutes later, we were up at Sink's place. We reported him, tanks ahead, and reasoned that we were at Bastogne. Bastogne had a road net of 7 roads that the Germans had to have to move around that forest area, or else they could move if they had snow, and we were having snow to begin with right then and there. We had a lot of snow. We formulated around Bastogne like a spoke in the wheel. The hub of the wheel was Bastogne. We were the spokes. The whole 101st Airborne Division had units around these spokes, and we were late getting up into it because the last unit of the 101st was cut off. They were cut off. They were the hospital unit of the 101st Airborne Division, the entire hospital unit. We had hospital squads and so forth and so on, but these were the hospital units. We stayed there for 29 miserable cold days, 17 degrees zero. The temperatures and the weather was worse than the enemy as far as I was concerned, but there were plenty of enemies. Day after Christmas, the sky broke. We were able to get resupplies, blue parachutes, red parachutes, and white parachutes, food, mail, and ammunition. We sent out men to retrieve the bundles from the parachutes. A few more days, a few more skirmishes. We picked up, my platoon picked up a number of German and American uniforms. We got all the information we needed out of them except one group that came in a bunch of 7. They didn't want to talk too much, but we found out who the leader was, and we had to dispatch him pretty quickly to get them to talk. And they talked, they sang like canaries after we did to him what we told the others we were going to do to them. We were dispatched back to France, at which time we were given another mission to go into the Ruhr. We went into the Ruhr. Light fighting, we accomplished everything we had to accomplish. The next interesting thing was that we came across our first concentration camp. We did not liberate a concentration camp. By the time we got there, the Germans had gone. They flew. If the Germans were there when we got there, my platoon would have dispatched them very quickly with a shot to the head for every one of them for what we saw. No human being should ever be given an opportunity to see what we saw at Landsberg. And I thought that was the worst thing that we could have ever imagined in our lifetime, until I was told to go to another place that night by Colonel Sink. We were in Landsberg, ready to go down to the Alps area where that we had heard that they were forming a redoubt area either near Salzburg or by Munich, where we did not exactly know. That night, Colonel Sink called me. He says he has some information about another one of these camps that probably was the headquarters of all these camps that we were in that day. And he told me that this was a satellite camp of what this big camp was to be its headquarters. And he wanted me to take one of my men, German-speaking men, the next morning and find out what it was and report back to him. they were going on the road to Salzburg. And he showed me the road that they were going to travel. And I had no problem finding it after we got the information that he wanted about this main camp. Unknown to me at that time or anyone else, that the name of that camp was Dachau. Exactly where it was, we did not know, but he had indications it was to be on so-and-so road that I took the next morning. About 20 minutes out the camp of Dachau, we had this odor in the air. It was the same odor that we detected before we got to Landsberg concentration camp. The driver of my Jeep and I both said to each other, we probably have found this camp. And sure enough, when we got there, it was Dachau. I'd never, ever, would ever expect any human being to see the sights that we saw there. And I've seen those sights every night of my life for 69 and a half, 70 years or more. When we got into the camp, we were told to find out something about it. We finally found one man that could speak a little English. He was a Polish inmate that was a baker. He'd come from a little town called Zwei, near Dresden, on the Polish border of Germany. His family had been murdered by the Nazis. For some reason or other, they made him a baker at Dachau. He had been a baker since the beginning of World War II. When I talk about it, my tongue is a little tied. Anyhow, he was trying to give us some few facts of what we were looking at and what we were seeing. One particular thing we couldn't understand, we saw this one inmate, a woman, a human skeleton, and we asked him why she was reacting quite a bit differently from the others. She looked totally crazy. And he said there was a reason that she was that way. When she came in to camp a few months before, just a few months before, with her daughter, the matron who was in charge of the women there grabbed her daughter, and this woman grabbed her back and screamed about her daughter. The woman immediately put the daughter down on the floor. She was about 11 years old, pushed her down on the floor, stomped the guts out of her till her guts came out of her mouth. The woman became crazy, and that's what we saw. And I could go on and on about the things we saw, and I can't describe them. We left there the next day, thank God. We got back on the road, we found our convoy. We next ended up at the Eagle's Nest in Birch's Garden. Naturally, we did what any God-fearing soldier would do. We looted the whole place of everything that we wanted, mostly of the silverware that had Hitler's name imprinted and everything else. I got a little bit of the silverware plus a bottle of cognac, Hennessy cognac. And on the bottle of cognac it says, for the Fuhrer's use only, 5-star Hennessy. Day later, the word got out that they will have a showdown inspection of everything that we possessed. And those that did not present themselves with the showdown loot and all the clothes we had may be sorry for the reason that we may not get home as quickly as we thought we may, because the war was coming to a quick end. Colonel Sink gathered up the silver, and he had a silversmith, the best silversmith in Europe, from Linz, Austria, come to Berchtesgaden. He was given the order of having this silver smelted down to make cups for the original 506 officers. I inquired about being an officer, but I wasn't at the Corps. They said, you will get one, which I did. After the Eagle's Nest, we were scattered around various towns in Bavaria, and we ended up, my company ended up in Bar-le-Duc, France, with the regimental headquarters, and another, I forgot which one of the battalions, it was two battalions and my headquarters company, where Colonel Sink was. The second atomic bomb was dropped when we were at Bar-le-Duc, and we knew that the war was completely over. And I had never been at any place or anywhere late or failing to report for duty when I was supposed to report for duty with the right uniform or the right equipment. But that time I decided that I wanted to visit Paris. Paris was 95 miles away, and I had about 19 of the most beautiful pistols that you've ever seen, handmade, all of them, German pistols.